वेरी वार्म वेलकम टू थॉरो न्यूज़पेपर एनालिसिस व्हिच इज प्रेजेंटेड टू यू बाय लॉ सीखो. सो टुडे वी विल डिस्कस इंपॉर्टेंट आर्टिकल्स फ्रॉम द न्यूज़पेपर ऑफ 25 मई 2021. This newspaper analysis is presented to you by me. My name is Ankita Parida. I have completed my BTech from IIIT Bhubaneswar and MTech from ITR, and I have completed my LLB in 2020, and presently I am working as a trainee associate with LawSeco. You can reach out to me at my LinkedIn or Twitter handle, which is mentioned here. So today we have two important articles of the day. The first article is titled as Expanding the Scope of POSCO. This article talks about the controversies and lacunas in the POSCO Act and the way through it. The second article is titled as Spike in the Other Caseload. This article talks about the caseload on the judiciary and how it can be tackled. Lastly, we have some item in the news and flash section, which is important for prelims purposes. So moving to the MCQ question of the day, who is the author of epic Sanskrit poem Sita Charitram and Swatantra Swabhavam? Your options are option A, Mahakavi Kalidas, option B, Guljar, option C, Pandit Rewa Prasad Drivedi, and option D, Dhayabhai Sastri. The descriptive question for the day is, POSCO Act was formulated to effectively address sexual abuse and sexual exploitation of children and pornography. Discuss various challenges associated with this act. You can write your answers in 250 to 300 words. So the first article of the day talks about the expanding the scope of POSCO or Protection of Child from Sexual Offences Act. This law was enacted in 2012 and it has been 9 years since then. However, there has been many controversies around it and there have been many lacunas which have been pointed by the author of this article. So recently, the Bombay High Court had given a judgment in which it had interpreted the skin-to-skin contact. It had said that in order to establish a sexual act, there needs to be skin-to-skin contact. However, this decision was injuncted by the Supreme Court. The author in this article has pointed out another controversy that is regarding the historical cases. It has been seen that many cases are not reported then and there when it is occurred in case of the children because of many issues such as they face physical and mental trauma when such kind of sexual abuse are going on with them. It is often seen that intrafamilial abuses are happening with the children in our society and they are not able to report it because it takes time to recognize that something like sexual abuse is happening with them, and it also takes time to comprehend the gravity of the situation. So it is very difficult to gain confidence and report the abuse then and there. Therefore, it takes time to report even after the limitation period has been finished. Prior to the enactment of this act in 2012, any reporting of the offense under Section 354 of IPC, which talks about outraging the modesty of women, is barred after 3 years from the date of incident by CRPC. However, in the historical child sexual abuse case, if a child reports after 10 years or 15 years of this case, then it will be counter to the principle of criminal law, which says that every act of crime must be reported at the earliest. And because of this, it sometimes hinders and prohibits the judicial magistrate to take cognizance beyond specific time. There has also been seen that because of this late reporting, there is lack of evidence and the perpetrator can easily escape the sentence. It has also been established that various circumstances around the child abuse is seen, which are the major factors for delay in reporting. These are threats from the perpetrators or fear from public humiliation or there is absence of any trustworthy confidant in the family. And lastly, it has been seen that many a times people's specifically the children suffer from accommodation syndrome. That is, child keeps the abuse as a secret due to fear that no one will believe in that abuse. Same was the case happened with an activist named as Poonima Govindarajulu. In 2018, she reported a sexual abuse case after 40 years. However, the police was not willing to file the case and she faced the problem in filing an FIR. Therefore, she filed an online petition and gathered people from around the world on the online platform and asked the clarification from the Ministry of Law. And based on this clarification, the Ministry of Law and Justice, at the request of Ministry of Women and Child Development, clarified that no time limit shall apply to the POSCO cases. However, this is a single occurrence that the ministry has clarified it. However, there are no clear guidelines or law regarding this. And therefore, to make it more clearer and give better guidelines to the public to file cases of historical cases of sexual abuse under the POSCO, the government should bring into the light any guideline or law or amendment and revise the law accordingly so that people are aware of this thing. Second article talks about the pendency across the judiciary. So the courts have not worked with full caseload since March 2020, resulting in an increasing number of pending cases in all levels of judiciary. So we have seen that either the courts are semi-functional or non-functional at some times because of this prolonged pandemic which is going on. In March 2020, there was a standing 3.68 crore pending cases which have now increased to 4.42 crores now, which is a very huge number. And it is predicted that by the time physical functioning begins, there will be likely or more than 5 crores pending cases. So what did the government do about it? Government increased the limitation period so that the cases can be filed even after the expiry of the limitation period. Also, it took two other steps, that is digital functioning and procedural revamping. In digital functioning, what it did that it introduced digital hearing of cases. However, this just acted as a mirage in the judicial system because, as we know, India has a huge digital divide. It is not a successful model even in the education sector. Then how we can expect that it will work effectively in the judiciary where the common man or the poor or the illiterate and the general public of the country is involved? So the digital divide ensured that the digital functioning of the courts could not function very well. Except for bail and other exigencies, the court below the Supreme Court and High Court are not capable of tackling with the cases. The second thing what the government did is procedural revamping. It thought of quick fixes, that is, by reclassifying matters, for example, decriminalize the check bounce case. However, these cases could reappear as a criminal complaint of cheating, or it could again come in front of the judiciary as civil recovery proceeding. Also, this procedural revamping or these quick fixes alter the rights of the parties and bring uncertainties in law. So, what can be the real solution to this? So, first, the author suggests that there must be a substantial increase in the strength of judicial services and there must be appointment of more judges at the subordinate level. As we know, the High Court and the Supreme Court cannot handle all the caseload. Therefore, it is very essential that we should focus on appointing more judges and fixing the vacancies, which is more than 30% presently, to the subordinate courts and the district courts, which are lacking the number of judges. Also, here another issue can be fixed, that is revamping the infrastructure of these subordinate courts. District courts lack infrastructure, and even they cannot sometimes function in digital method because of lack of technical and infrastructural support by the government. Secondly, the author suggests that this can be taken as an opportunity to correct the historical inequalities, and women and the marginalized communities and caste can be given a fair share of seat as judges in the judicial system. So therefore, for this, the government need to bring more expenditure in this sector and increase its spending in judiciary so that more number of judges can be appointed in it, and therefore strengthening the judiciary and thus decreasing the pendency of the cases. Lastly, we have the news in flash section. Union Health Minister Dr. Harshvardhan has chaired the assembly of 74th World Health Assembly. So it is happening on a virtual platform, which is happening from 24th May to 1st June 2021. And our Union Health Minister, Dr. Harshvardhan, has chaired the assembly. The theme for 2021 is ending this pandemic, preventing the next, building together a healthier, safer, and fairer world. The second news item is first phase of data analytics-driven MCA21. So Union Minister Anurag Thakur launched the first phase of MCA21. MCA21 is basically an e-governance initiative by the Ministry of Corporate Affairs, and this is the version 3.0. And this module comes with three add-ons, that is e-adjudication, e-consultation, and compliance management. As per the ministry, the step will accelerate the rate of economic activity for realizing the dreams of India becoming the economic powerhouse. Thirdly, the Sputnik V to be produced in India. As we know, the Sputnik V is a vaccine by the Russia, and Russia Direct Investment Fund, RDIF, and Pankia Biotech began producing this vaccine in India. The target is 1 crore doses for the first year. So this was all for today. Thank you.